New Society Publishers presents Power, Limits and Prospects for Human Survival by Richard Heinberg, narrated by David Skulski. Note to the listener, this audiobook has a supplemental PDF. To download it, visit newsociety.com. Dedication for the survivors. Acknowledgements. First off, I acknowledge the staggering level of privilege that made this book possible. I have been fortunate to be able to spend much of my life reading, thinking, and writing, and I've traveled to roughly 20 countries, rich and poor, where I've had the opportunity to learn both from trained observers of nature and society and from groups of people self-organizing to solve environmental and social problems. Further, pursuing my career has entailed damage to ecosystems as a result of transportation and other resource consumption that will impact other living beings and future generations of humans. Relatively few individuals have been able to enjoy such advantages. I can only hope that this book represents a worthwhile return on society's and nature's investment, if I may be permitted to frame the situation this way. I am deeply grateful to my colleagues at Post Carbon Institute and to those who have donated to our organization for materially supporting me as I worked uninterrupted for many months on the manuscript. Thanks especially to Asher Miller, the Institute's executive director, Rob Dietz, our program director, and Daniel Lerch, our publications director, for being thoughtful and knowledgeable sounding boards for drafts of the book as it developed. Daniel also expertly shepherded the process of finding a publisher, putting together the illustrations, and handling planning and correspondence related to the publication process. Thanks also to Amy Buringrud for spearheading our marketing efforts, and Desiree Cesarini for managing events in support of this project. I again feel privileged, in this case, to work with such competent and conscientious colleagues. Thanks to Kristen Anton, who did the extensive revelatory research and calculations for the sidebar, How Much Power? My appreciation also goes out to Craig Collins, who made key suggestions regarding several chapters, especially the last. Special thanks to Joni Praded, who read versions of the introduction and the early chapters and helped me make these key parts of the book more easily understandable to a wider range of readers. I'd like to publicly acknowledge my gratitude to the team at New Society Publishers, notably acquisitions editor Rob West, who somehow understood the usefulness of this project at a time when big-picture books about the human condition have fallen out of fashion. Kudos also to Julie Radish, publisher, Sue Constance, publishing director, E.J. Hurst, sales director, Sarah Reeves, marketing director, and the rest of the staff, who all contributed to a successful release. Murray Rice deserves credit for meticulous copy editing. Finally, I must once again acknowledge the support of my wife, Janet Barocco, whose love of nature, art, music, and good food fills our lives with beauty, thereby providing a stable foundation from which I've been able to launch my unsettling investigations and critiques of the unsustainable underpinnings of modern industrial society. Introduction. Many people are searching for a magic formula to save the world from the converging crises of the 21st century. Climate change, economic inequality, air and water pollution, resource depletion, and the catastrophic disappearance of wildlife threaten to upend society while destabilizing our planet to such a degree that it may be impossible for future generations of humans to persist. What if we could solve all these problems with one simple trick? Don't hold your breath. A single solution doesn't exist. It's not socialism or capitalism. It's not renewable energy or nuclear power. It's not religion or atheism. And it's not hemp. However, I believe there is a single causative agent in back of most of our troubles, the understanding of which could indeed help us emerge from the hole we're rapidly digging for ourselves. That causative agent is power. our pursuit of it, our overuse of it, and our abuse of it. In this book, I argue that all the problems mentioned above, and others as well, are problems of power. We humans are nature's supreme power addicts. Power, the ability to do something, the ability to get someone else to do something, or the ability to prevent someone else from doing something, is everywhere in the human world. We obsess over power in its various forms, from wealth to governmental authority, to weaponry, to the concentrated energy sources that make modern industrial societies run. We seek power in many ways, but doing so often gets us into trouble, and it may be our downfall as a species. Seeing the converging crises of this century as problems of power doesn't change much, in that we're still left fighting a host of individual battles. After all, recognizing that climate change is a problem of power, as I argue in Chapter 5, doesn't make it easier for nations to reduce their carbon emissions. Yet, it also changes everything. It reveals how our current existential crises are related and suggests a common meta-strategy for dealing with them. One might think that everything that could possibly be written on the subject of power already has been. At least, that's what I thought when I began the journey that led to this book. There are thousands of tomes that discuss subjects related to power in one or another of its many manifestations, and hundreds with the word power in their titles. But no book that I'm aware of has systematically examined the sundry forms of power and investigated how they are related, how they arose, and what they mean for us today. Perhaps the reason no author has addressed power so broadly is that it is a topic that's both huge and apparently nebulous. How to make sense of something so incomprehensibly vast and varied? Why even try? When I started the research that would culminate in this book, I wasn't compelled by a burning interest in power per se. Rather, I was driven to better understand the problems that imbalances and abuses of power have caused. I was determined to find answers to three survival-level questions. 1. How has Homo sapiens, just one species out of millions, become so powerful as to bring the planet to the brink of climate chaos and a mass extinction event? 2. Why have we developed so many ways of oppressing and exploiting one another? 3. Is it possible to change our relationship with power so as to avert ecological catastrophe while also dramatically reducing social inequality and the likelihood of political economic collapse? In their essence, these questions had dogged me my entire adult life, though it's only in the last few years that I've been able to distill them down to these few words. As I pondered these questions, it became increasingly clear that reliable answers required a clearer understanding of power in and of itself, since it's the thread tying together our critical human problems and their potential solutions. What is power? I decided to do a literature search. Not only was I dismayed to find no existing comprehensive investigation of the nature and workings of power, but I began to notice that, in books that discuss it, power is often poorly defined, if it's defined at all. I wondered if that was because no one had thought to trace the story of power back to its beginnings. Physicists define power as the rate of energy transfer. That, at least, is a precise definition and one that enables power to be measured quantitatively. Does it provide a good place to start in better understanding the power of, say, great wealth or high political office? That seemed doubtful at first. Nevertheless, I already knew the importance of energy in recent history, having written several books about fossil fuels and renewable energy alternatives. Further, one of the most important lessons I had learned during my years of examining these subjects was that if you want to understand any ecosystem or human society, a good rule of thumb is to follow the energy. I wondered if by starting with the process of energy transfer and tracing its development through biological evolution and human history up to the present, it might be possible to better grasp what power is and how it works, and, in the bargain, to get a better idea of how to deal with our converging power problems. My goal would not be to reduce the complex world of social power to energy, so that political influence, for example, could be measured in watts, but simply to better grasp how our many forms of power arose and how they relate to one another, and thereby discover if there are indeed solutions to our impending survival dilemmas. This focus on energy turned out to be a way not just of making power more comprehensible, but also of tying together a wide range of disparate phenomena in fields from cell biology to ecology to psychology to geopolitics. Most importantly, it threw new light on my three questions, leading me to surprising ideas for changing power dynamics, changing our personal behavior, changing our communities, and changing the world. The third of my motivating questions, the most crucial one, is, of course, still open. But in the pages that follow, I test the widespread belief that the pursuit of power is irrepressible, that bullies will forever be bullies, that the high and mighty will ultimately triumph, and that people in wealthy countries will never willingly give up comforts and conveniences in order to forestall global environmental catastrophe. Boiled down to its basics, this belief holds that the will to power overwhelms all other human motives. There is evidence to support that belief. As I discussed in Chapter 1, biologists tend to agree that evolution has been driven by the maximum power principle, according to which, among directly competing systems, the one that harnesses available energy most effectively will prevail. Human beings' pursuit of power is rooted in nature. Evolutionary precursors of it can be seen in competition between species for territory and food, and between members of the same species for mating opportunities. Nature is a power struggle. However, it's also clear there is more going on, both in nature and in human societies. Evolution has found ways of preventing species from attaining so much power that they overrun environmental limits. And human societies have evolved ways of reining in tyrants, sharing and conserving resources, and limiting inequality. In Chapter 6, I propose a new biosocial principle in evolution, the optimum power principle, to describe these pathways. Strategies to avert the concentration of too much power, whether in nature or human affairs, are partial and imperfect. They can't prevent occasional excesses. A case in point. Evolution has no precedent for the immense power that humanity has recently derived from fossil fuels. Coal, oil, and natural gas have enabled humans to increase their total energy usage 40-fold in the span of just 3 human lifetimes, a rate of increase that's likely far greater than any previous power shift since the dawn of life on Earth. But fossil fuels are finite and depleting resources, and burning them destabilizes the global climate. So we are left in a precarious spot. We will have to adapt at an unprecedented pace to limit this excess power or risk societal and ecosystem collapse. Help may come from an unexpected source. Beauty, compassion, and inspiration can influence or motivate human behavior. In a sense, then, these are powers too, though of a kind fundamentally different from the political, military, and economic powers that run our world. Yet, as we will see, beauty has helped drive biological evolution, and transcendent qualities of human character have shaped history. If we are to survive this century, we may need to rely on and develop these powers as never before. Again, there is no silver bullet here. Even though I suggest specific ways of limiting power that could address the main crises of our time, I can't promise that these suggestions are politically realistic or likely to be implemented. What's the point, then? By better understanding power, I believe we can gain a clearer view of the human condition, reaping not just knowledge, but perspective and perhaps even wisdom. Practical applications may follow. The story of humanity's fascination with power begins with 4 key advantages that we have exploited to a far greater degree than any other species on Earth. The ability to make and manipulate tools, which we were able to develop because of our opposable thumbs and big brains. Language, which enabled us to coordinate our behavior over time and space. Social complexity, which makes human societies more cooperative and formidable, though usually at the expense of increased inequality. And our ability to harness energy beyond that which is supplied by food and exerted through muscle. Power chronicles how these advantages have propelled us on a trajectory from hunter-gatherer life in small wandering bands to modern existence in huge cities, surrounded by machines and able to summon highly desirable foods and manufactured goods with a keystroke. At the same time, power inequality, including the power differential between women and men, has tended to grow in human societies, though in fits and starts, and with occasional reversals. In the story of social power, starring roles have been played by three kinds of tools: money, which can best be thought of as quantifiable, storable, and transferable social power, and as a token for the ability to command energy; weapons, which have enabled ever more sophisticated and deadly forms of warfare, while also helping drive cultural evolution; and communication technologies, from writing to social media, which have given some people the ability to influence the minds of many others. Money, weapons, and communication technologies, the key tools of social power, have enabled relatively few human beings to wield extraordinary influence. Today, just a few extremely rich individuals claim as much wealth as the poorer half of humanity, and we find ourselves asking whether such extreme levels of inequality are sustainable. New cross-disciplinary analysis of hundreds of societies from the past 5,000 years offers unprecedented insight into how and why social and economic inequality arises, and the trajectory on which it tends to propel societies. As we'll see, worsening inequality tends to lead to cycles of societal expansion followed by ages of discord. Military power is perhaps the rawest form of social power. We'll trace how it evolved from hand-to-hand combat to the point where a single soldier can obliterate hundreds, even millions of combatants and non-combatants without ever seeing their faces or hearing their anguished cries. In the past century, some of our weapons have become so awesome that our only prospect for collective survival lies in never using them. We'll also see how warfare contributed to the origin of early city-states, with full-time division of labor, the creation of empires, and the modern trend toward economic globalization. The powers to communicate quickly over great distances, to heal injuries and cure diseases, to travel safely and quickly halfway around the world in a day, and to explore other planets, seem benign by comparison. Yet all these powers, whether used to dominate or enable, are connected and follow some of the same basic principles. We'll explore in Chapter 1 how living creatures evolved fascinating and ingenious ways of deriving and exerting power. Power enables not just individual survival, but the production of breathtaking variety and beauty throughout nature. But it is possible to have too much of a good thing. And that, I argue, is the essence of the human predicament in the 21st century. It is also possible, of course, to abuse power, and as we will see, the problem of the abuse of power is often closely related to that of the overaccumulation of power, as historians who study the careers of dictators continually remind us. Indeed, the overaccumulation of power makes the abuse of power increasingly likely. Altogether, in response to the three questions I posed earlier, this book will leave the reader with six takeaways. 1. Power is everywhere. We can't understand nature or human society without investigating the workings of power. 2. Our human ability to overwhelm nature and our tendency toward extreme inequality have both evolved in discrete stages. That is, in neither case was evolution a steady process. It's possible to pinpoint key moments in biological evolution and social evolution when everything changed due to a dramatic power shift. 3. There is a fundamental correlation between physical power and social power. Social scientists sometimes tend to downplay this point. But throughout history, dramatic increases in physical power derived from new technologies and from harnessing new energy sources have often tended to lead to more vertical social power. That's a phrase we'll unpack as we go along. It basically means a few people having more wealth than everybody else, or being able to tell lots of other people what to do. 4. Our problems with power result not just from abuse. We're rightly outraged by abuses of power in the forms of slavery, despotism, corruption, racism, sexism, and so on. But sometimes the accumulation of too much power within a system is problematic regardless of the benign or sinister intent of system managers. 5. The will to power, about which German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche wrote, is real, but it isn't everything. We humans have other instincts that counteract our relentless pursuit of power. Efforts to limit power are deeply rooted in nature's cycles and balancing mechanisms and have been expressed in countless social movements over many centuries, including movements to curb the power of rulers, to abolish slavery, and to grant women political rights equal to those enjoyed by men. 6. The power of beauty has driven biological evolution as surely as has the pursuit of dominance, and the power of inspiring example has shaped human social evolution as much as the quests for wealth and superior weaponry. These aren't just feel-good sentiments. They're research-based observations. Finally, an overview of the book's structure. Chapter 1 explores power in nature. When discussing power, it's tempting to jump directly into an examination of social power in human groups. However, social power is based in biology, and it's necessary to investigate power's evolutionary roots if we're to understand its manifestations in the modern world. This chapter is a whirlwind tour of the biology of power. It addresses the ways power moves through the living world, starting with the cell's ability to capture, store, and controllably dissipate energy. We'll explore the manifold powers of living things, including motion, perception, communication, reproduction, emotion, and deception. As we'll see, power comes in many forms, and specializing in any one kind of power tends to result in a trade-off with others. Chapter 2 focuses on how humans developed extraordinary and unique powers during the Pleistocene epoch, starting roughly 2.5 million years ago. Using recent findings in archaeology and anthropology, we will trace the earliest human uses of stone tools, fire, and clothing, revealing how they enabled our ancestors to expand their range and their competitive advantages over other large-bodied mammals and other human species. As we'll see, tools and fire changed us as much as we changed the world by using them. We'll explore how language supercharged our other powers by enabling us to explain processes, like the manufacturing of ever more complicated tools, tell stories, and ask questions. Finally, we'll trace the trajectory of power relations between women and men in prehistory and explore Homo sapiens' long-standing fascination with the power of beauty. Chapter 3 outlines the evolution of vertical social power, how some people gained influence over others. Most of the key milestones in this process occurred in the Holocene epoch, that is, during the past 11,000 years. As our early ancestors began domesticating animals and plants and growing crops, they also created a wealth pump that continually generated economic inequality. We'll see how the adoption of a symbolic medium of exchange and basis for the creation and payment of debt, i.e. money, led to a near-universal, self-regulating system of wealth and poverty. We'll see how early agriculturalists applied the skills they developed in domesticating animals to the project of controlling other people. We'll also investigate the power conferred by communication tools, from writing to the printing press to social media. Finally, in a section titled Pathologies of Power, we'll examine the ways in which vertical social power often makes us literally crazy. Chapter 4 focuses on the period of time I'll be calling the Great Acceleration. It's during this brief historical moment, roughly the past 200 years, that trends like climate change and rapid population growth have really taken off. This chapter reveals how the fossil fuel revolution enabled us dramatically to increase resource extraction, manufacturing, and consumption in a historic eye blink, causing the middle class to balloon and consumerism to blossom. We'll also see how the worst human impacts on our environment and the most lethal wars ever have occurred due to the powers that coal, oil, and natural gas have conferred on us. Chapter 5 explores the consequences of unleashing the energy of millions of years' worth of ancient sunlight, stored as fossil fuels, into a world of finely tuned natural checks and balances. This chapter is an unflinching look at what's going wrong in the 21st century. Climate change, resource depletion, and species extinctions all result from humans exercising enormous and growing power over our environment. Meanwhile, our expanding energetic powers have sent the wealth pump, common to all complex societies, into overdrive, so that economic inequality is growing to absurd extremes. People in past societies amassed power in similar ways, but on a smaller scale, and it never ended well. Fortunately, it is possible to rein in excessive power. In Chapter 6, we'll see how evolution has provided for the limitation of power in other species, and how, throughout history, we humans have found ways to check our own powers, both over nature and over one another. We'll see how our inner powers of empathy and self-control have led to moderation and peace in previous historical moments and could do so again. In the course of pursuing power over nature and one another, we have also created art, music, literature, spirituality, and science, our most sublime achievements. And we are capable of remarkable acts of creativity, compassion, mercy, and self-sacrifice. Chapter 7 is about the future of power. It examines the specific ways we must alter our relationship with power in order to prevent a premature end to the human experiment. We'll look at the worst and best case scenarios for our deep future and the power trade-offs that will determine our actual trajectory. As we will see, limiting our dominance of nature and of other people while maximizing self-control could make life not only more secure, but also far more beautiful for ourselves and our descendants. This book argues that in principle we can indeed overcome our current crises of over-empowerment and power imbalance. That doesn't mean we will. As I point out in the last section of Chapter 6, humanity is in a unique situation now, wherein, because of fossil fuels, we've succeeded in overcoming certain limits on energy, food, population, debt, and scale of social organization that kept previous societies within critical bounds. Our very success is blinding us to the fact that limits nevertheless still exist and are, in fact, looming. So the odds are that we won't escape some form of societal collapse, fast or slow, complete or partial, during the current century. My reason for writing this book is that I believe it is vital that as many people as possible understand the following point. Whatever degree of resilience or sustainability we can achieve prior to, during, or after collapse must come from a return to self-limiting behaviors. The call for power-limiting behavior is implicit in a great deal of existing environmental, social justice, and spiritual literature. This book makes that call explicit. Grounds it in physics, biology, anthropology, and history, brings it up to date, and underscores what is at stake. In the years ahead, human survival will depend on our ability to reckon with power in all its forms. If this book can help even marginally in that process, it will have done its job. Sidebar 1. Defining power. Power is a familiar word, but it has several distinct meanings. I explore its meanings throughout this book and specify which meaning I am using in any given context. To avoid confusion, let's consider these definitions at the outset. In physics, power is defined as the rate of transfer of energy. Using a unit of measurement, such as the watt, it is possible to precisely specify the power of an engine, the power of an asteroid crashing into a planet, or the power of human arm and leg muscles used in digging a ditch or carrying a heavy weight. Physical power can be used to accomplish goals. We often think of physical power simply as the ability to do something. We speak of the power of speech or the power of flight. But these are just two of an astonishing number of things that can be done by harnessing energy in particular ways. Chapter 1 explores how living organisms gradually evolved to use energy to gain an ever-expanding repertoire of abilities. Chapter 2 zeroes in on the evolution of key human abilities, especially language, tool-making, and control of fire, that have given us dramatic advantages over other creatures. In normal conversation, most of us tend to use the word power to refer to social power, which can be defined as the ability to get other people to do something. A political leader or a billionaire has this kind of power. Chapter 3 explores the evolution of social power since the emergence of kings and money, roughly 4,000 years ago. Not all social power is the same. Horizontal social power is the ability of a group to self-organize to accomplish something. The implicit message is, we can do this together. This is the power at work in a self-organizing social movement or a mob. Societies characterized by horizontal power include hunter-gatherer bands and, to a degree, successful modern democracies. Vertical social power is the ability to get others to do something through a threat or incentive. The implicit message is, you must do this or else, or if you do this, I will give you that. This is the power wielded, for example, by a judge or an employer. Societies highly characterized by vertical power include early agrarian kingdoms and modern totalitarian dictatorships. The line separating vertical from horizontal power can be somewhat blurry. Social movements have leaders, dictators often appeal to mob instincts, and modern democracies have police and prisons. Still another form of social power is the ability to exclude others from having access to something. The implicit message is, this is mine and I will prevent you from having it. Like many other forms of power, exclusionary power developed in nature long before the appearance of humans, as we will see in Chapter 1. However, modern humans have developed exclusionary power to a high degree through laws defining property rights and through wars over land and other resources. Some forms of social power are hard to define or measure. We say that ideas have power, but ideas must have human hosts to continually give them life. Creative artists have the power to move their audiences emotionally and aesthetically. Many spiritual and political leaders gain followers through the power of inspiration and example, or force of personality. Finally, sexual attraction exerts an undeniable power that shapes nature and human affairs. These definitions and types of power may seem disparate and unrelated. However, as we will see, one kind of power tends to lead to another. By tracing the relationships between varied manifestations of power, starting with energy transfer, we begin to see patterns and connections that would otherwise be invisible. History and current events emerge with greater clarity when viewed through the lens of power. 1. Power in nature, from mitochondria to emotion and deception. The way in which mitochondria generate energy is one of the most bizarre mechanisms in biology. Its discovery has been compared with those of Darwin and Einstein. Mitochondria pump protons across a membrane to generate an electric charge with the power, over a few nanometers, of a bolt of lightning. This proton power is harnessed by the elementary particles of life, mushroom-shaped proteins in the membrane, to generate energy in the form of ATP. This radical mechanism is as fundamental to life as DNA itself, and gives an insight into the origin of life on Earth. Nick Lane, Power, Sex, Suicide. The maximum power principle can be stated. During self-organization, system designs develop and prevail that maximize power intake, energy transformation, and those uses that reinforce production and efficiency. Howard T. Odum, Maximum Power. Everything in the world is about sex, except sex. Sex is about power. Oscar Wilde. Power is everywhere, and is the basis of, well, everything. Without it, literally nothing can happen. Exploring the origins and evolution of power helps us better grasp how it shapes the human world today, and why our recently developed abilities to dramatically magnify and concentrate human power now threaten both humanity itself and the natural world on which we all depend. While we have come to dominate other species and to transform our planet, and some of us have grown far wealthier and more influential than others, our powers are puny in universal terms. The universe is shaped by cosmic forces, gravity, which is nearly undetectable as an attractive force between two human-sized masses, but which shapes galaxies and the orbits of planets. Nuclear fusion, which occurs due to forces in atomic nuclei and causes stars to emit enormous amounts of energy. And the electromagnetic force, which is responsible for the intense magnetic fields in rapidly rotating, charged black holes that can accelerate particles to spectacular speeds and energy levels. One particular star, our Sun, is the ultimate source of most power on our planet. Whether it's the physical power of a hurricane or the social power of a successful political movement, after all, the people who form that movement have to eat, and the energy in their food comes from the Sun. The Sun radiates energy largely in the form of light, far and wide throughout space, but only a tiny fraction of the Sun's total output falls on Earth. Even so, this minuscule portion is enough to heat the planet's surface so as to keep most ocean water in a liquid state and to drive the weather that stirs our atmosphere. Sunlight has also powered the most amazing development in the entire solar system, the evolution of living things. The process by which biological evolution got started is still the subject of research and speculation. We'll explore it more in a moment. But the results, after over 4 billion years, are all around us in the forms of millions of species of plants, animals, microbes, and fungi, and of complex ecosystems, each containing many species, each species adapted to others, and all adapted to particular regimes of moisture, temperature, and climate. Every organism is able to capture some of the Sun's energy as that energy flows through the Earth's systems. And each organism has found a way to dissipate that captured energy in a controlled way. In doing so, every living thing wields powers of its own. Indeed, evolution favors those organisms and systems of organisms that use power more effectively than others do. Early natural scientists and philosophers, including Gottfried Leibniz and Vito Volterra, deduced somewhat intuitively that evolution works this way, but the process wasn't described in detail or given a name until the 20th century. Ecologist Howard Odum, who worked on the problem in the 1960s by building on the earlier efforts of biophysicist Alfred Lotka, called this evolutionary tendency the maximum power principle. It's a key concept for understanding power anywhere and everywhere in the living world. One way to think of this principle is that the species that exploits a given resource most effectively will tend to crowd out competing species. But if evolution favors power maximization, then why didn't a single powerful organism emerge early in Earth's history and dominate the planet from then on? The diversity of life results from the fact that there are many ways to exert power, and many different environments in which to do so. As we'll see during the course of this book, one species has recently taken charge of virtually the entire planet as a result of its ability to maximize power in a host of ways. And we, of course, are members of that species. However, many fundamental powers began to evolve in organisms long before humans appeared. While this book is mainly about the evolution of power in human societies, especially in recent decades, it's much easier to grasp the nature and sources of human power if we ground our exploration of the subject in the wider evolution of power throughout natural systems. Doing so also reminds us of some biological principles that we'll refer back to as we consider natural limits to the seemingly endless extension of human powers. In this chapter, we'll take a look at some of the powers that arose in living things long before humans emerged. Then, in subsequent chapters, we'll see how humans have amplified these already existing potentials. We'll see how the drive for power makes us both cooperative and competitive. How all organisms have learned to limit their powers in order to develop and diversify. And how evolution turned higher animals like us into worshippers of beauty that are often willing to sacrifice some of our other powers for purely aesthetic purposes. Sidebar 2. Powers in math. Exponents, or powers, are a way of showing that a number is to be multiplied by itself repeatedly. In the expression 2 to the fifth, 2 is called the base, and 5 is called the exponent, or power. 2 to the fifth is shorthand for multiply 5 twos together. 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 equals 32. Powers of 10 are often used to express really big and very small numbers. This is called scientific notation. For example, the total power of modern industrial civilization can be expressed as 4 times 10 to the 13th watts. In ordinary decimal numeric notation, that would be 40 trillion watts. When using scientific notation, increasing the exponent by 1, that is, multiplying the number by 10, is often described as increasing its order of magnitude by 1. A quantity that is 10 times greater than another is therefore said to be larger by an order of magnitude. 2.5 times 10 to the 4th is an order of magnitude larger than 2.5 times 10 cubed. To express very small numbers, negative exponents can be used. 10 to the minus 3rd equals 1 over 10 cubed. Equals 1 over 10 times 10 times 10, equals 1 over 1,000. The number 10 to the minus 4 is an order of magnitude smaller than 10 to the minus 3. Scientific notation is useful in fields as varied as astrophysics, particle physics, biology, and engineering. It enables us not only to understand the vast variance in scale between the ultra-tiny and the incomprehensibly vast, but to operate across scales with technologies ranging from telescopes and microscopes to microprocessors, chemicals, spacecraft, and medicines. Powers of 10 enable us to peer into the nucleus of an atom or estimate the size of the universe. They broaden our understanding while also greatly enhancing our ability to influence and control our environment. The basis of life's power. In the final analysis, life is all about power. Every living organism wields the powers of growth, metabolism, and reproduction. Whether a bacterium, a blade of grass, or a towering giraffe, all life forms capture energy from their surroundings and dissipate that energy in a controlled way to maintain steady conditions within the boundary that separates them from their environment. Even the simplest organisms is a complex system able to control what's going on inside itself and able to manipulate its environment in some way to get what it needs to sustain itself. But how did life get started? Biologists have been puzzling over the question for at least the last couple of centuries. The process must have geared up remarkably early in Earth history. In 2017, researchers in Quebec found tiny filaments, knobs, and tubes, effectively fossils of single-celled creatures, in rocks thought to be up to 4.28 billion years old. The planet itself is believed to have formed 4.6 billion years ago, so evolution apparently wasted comparatively little time in getting going. These minute structures formed around hydrothermal vents at the bottom of ancient oceans. We'll see the significance of that in just a moment. Until recently, some researchers thought the evolution of life must have begun with viruses. Since they are much simpler than bacteria, they consist merely of bits of DNA or RNA wrapped in a protective coat of protein. But that theory has fallen out of favor. The problem is that viruses have no energy source. They depend on the energy of a host cell they've hijacked in order to reproduce themselves. Prior to the time such host cells existed, there would have been no way for viruses to have perpetuated themselves. Viruses must have evolved later. They likely started out as fully developed cells that gradually streamlined themselves by giving up their vital functions so they could more effectively piggyback on fully developed organisms. The most intriguing and convincing current theory of the origin of living things centers precisely on energy and power. Billions of years ago, volcanic seepage sites spewed iron and sulfur into ancient oceans. Those ocean waters were acidic close to the surface, but alkaline further down close to the sea floor. Tiny iron-sulfur bubbles formed around the volcanic vents, with membranes often just a single molecule in thickness. Similar bubbles can be observed today around deep-water volcanic vents. The outside of the bubble was more acidic than the inside. The membranes were also electrically conductive, and simple electrochemical processes would have shunted electrons to the inside of the bubbles and protons to the outside. This inside-outside difference in acidity and charge could have generated a difference in electrical potential across the bubble membrane of several hundred millivolts, roughly the same level of charge that powers bacteria to this day. The process just outlined would supply not only a source of energy, but also the basis for the synthesis of biochemicals, including the proteins necessary for life, amino acids, peptides, and RNA. This story of life's origin is convincing because it describes a process, separating electrons and protons, that still generates energy in every living cell throughout all of nature. Everything that every cell does requires energy, and each of the three basic energy-generating processes of life, respiration, fermentation, and photosynthesis, involves proton pumping. The proton pump that started life's evolution over 4 billion years ago still powers all of life on Earth today. Just how powerful is life? Astoundingly, on a gram-for-gram basis, the average organism is 10,000 times as powerful as the sun. How could this be? The sun generates an enormous amount of power, but it is also very massive. The math is simple. Dividing luminosity by mass yields a mere 0.0002 milliwatts of power per gram for the sun. A human, eating an average diet and converting that food energy into heat and work, averages 2 milliwatts per gram. Now, as we've seen, just about all the energy on Earth originated from the sun, so life's power is derivative. It comes from somewhere else. In contrast, the sun generates its own power. Nevertheless, the effectiveness of living things at appropriating and using energy is astonishing. Life is powerful indeed. Sidebar 3. Measures of physical power. Leaving aside its social manifestations, power is, at its simplest, the rate of energy transfer. Think of energy as water flowing from a fire hose. In terms of this metaphor, power is the rate at which water is emerging from the hose, which is determined by two factors, the diameter of the hose and the water pressure. If the hose is large but water pressure is low, there is not a powerful flow. Likewise, if the pressure is great but the hose is small. If the hose is large and the pressure is high, you'll have a powerful flow on your hands. The total amount of energy, or, in the metaphor, water, that is released is determined by rate of flow, power, over time. A rate of flow of 1 liter per second would, naturally, yield 60 liters in a minute. The unit of power most commonly used by scientists is the watt, named after the Scottish inventor James Watt, 1736 to 1819. The watt is defined as the transfer of 1 joule of energy per second. How much is that? Using a hand crank, you can apply roughly 8 watts of mechanical power. In terms of electrical power, a watt can run a single LED. Energy can be measured in watt-hours, power over time, as well as joules, calories, British thermal units, therms, and other units. Very small amounts of power can be expressed in terms of a nanowatt, 1 billionth, or 10⁻⁹, watts. A unit that can be useful in discussions about power in cell biology or the gravitational pull of a human-sized object. Large amounts of power can be measured in terms of a kilowatt, 1,000 or 10³ watts, a megawatt, 1,000,000 or 10⁶ watts, a gigawatt, 1,000,000,000 or 10⁹ watts, a terawatt, 1,000,000,000,000 or 10⁻½ watts, or a petawatt, 1 quadrillion or 10⁵ watts. A typical modern middle-income American household can operate all its appliances using approximately 1 to 3 kilowatts of electrical power. Sometimes power is discussed in terms of horsepower, HP. However, there are several different standards of horsepower. Two common ones are the mechanical or imperial horsepower, which is about 745.7 watts, and the metric horsepower, which is approximately 735.5 watts. One horsepower is only vaguely equivalent to the power of an average horse, and therein lies a story. When he was developing the steam engine, James Watt was visited by a brewer, who requested an engine that could match the power output of his biggest and strongest horse. Watt accepted the challenge and built a machine that exceeded the power of the brewer's horse. It was the output of that machine that became the basis for horsepower. So, how much power can an actual horse apply? A 1993 paper in Nature by R.D. Stevenson and R.J. Wassersug cited measurements made at the 1926 Iowa State Fair, where one horse was recorded at peak power over a few seconds at 14.9 HP, 11.1 kilowatts. However, they observed that for sustained activity, a work rate of about 1 HP, 0.75 kilowatts, per horse is indeed realistic. A healthy human can produce about 1.2 HP, 0.89 kilowatts, briefly, and sustain about 0.1 HP, 0.075 kilowatts, for longer periods. Trained athletes can manage up to about 2.5 HP, 1.9 kilowatts briefly, and 0.35 HP, 0.26 kilowatts over several hours. Three big powerful families. The earliest cells must have been simpler than today's single-celled organisms, which are the beneficiaries of billions of years of evolution. Even though they're tiny, they are highly organized internally and have diverse and sophisticated ways of making their way in the world. Today there are three broad kinds of cells, and therefore three branches of the tree of life: bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes. Bacteria are almost certainly the oldest of the three. Bacteria and archaea exist only as single-celled organisms, unless you count a bacterial colony as an organism. In some colonies of myxobacteria, individual bacteria specialize. They are also similar in that they lack nuclei. For a long time, biologists assumed that archaea were bacteria, but as more about them was discovered, it became clear that these are two fundamentally different kinds of life forms. Most bacteria are shaped like rods, spheres, or spirals. Most are also tiny, 0.5 to 5 micrometers in length, though a very few, such as Theo Margarita namibiensis, are up to 0.5 millimeter long, big enough to see with the naked eye. An individual bacterium is like a battery. The cell continually pumps protons out across its membrane into the periplasmic space between the membrane and the outer cell wall, thereby creating an electrical gradient. It does this by gathering electrons from its environment, passing them along a chemical chain, and using their combined negative charge to pump the protons outward. The creation of an electrical gradient around the bacterium can be compared to blowing air into a balloon. Pressurized air can later be used to do work, like turning a pinwheel. The electrical potential around the bacteria can be used as well for work such as chemical synthesis and reproduction. Bacteria can even use their proton pumping force to power locomotion. In order to maintain their electrical gradient, bacteria must have a source of extra electrons, and they have evolved several strategies for getting them. Some bacteria derive their electron energy from light through photosynthesis. Others, called chemotrophs, use chemical compounds as a source of electrons. See Power of Eating below. Chemotrophs are further divided by the types of compounds they use. Ones that use inorganic compounds like hydrogen, carbon monoxide, or ammonia are called lithotrophs, while those that use organic compounds are called organotrophs. Within bacteria, a different compound must receive the electrons from food in a chemical reaction in order for the cell to obtain and use energy. Aerobic bacteria use oxygen as the electron acceptor, while anaerobic bacteria use compounds such as nitrate, sulfate, or carbon dioxide. Even though bacteria generally lack the ability to form complex, multicelled individuals, they have evolved the ability to live in extremely varied environments, hot or cold, with air or without air, acidic or alkaline. They are also so good at producing such a huge range of chemicals that industrial biochemists are constantly finding new ways of harnessing them for commercial applications. Although archaea were at first thought of as bacteria, their genes are significantly different from those of bacteria, as are their cell walls and other cell structures. And so is their energy metabolism. They were discovered only in 1977, and are extremely difficult to culture and study in the laboratory. Only 250 species have been identified, compared to some 30,000 kinds of bacteria. Genetic differences suggest that archaea and bacteria probably split from a common ancestor 3.7 billion years ago. Though they are less numerous in the gut than bacteria, archaea are still plentiful in your digestive tract and on your skin. Eukaryotes, which have cell nuclei, appeared more recently, about 2.7 billion years ago. Unlike bacteria and archaea, they were able to form complex multicelled individuals. All plants, animals, and fungi are eukaryotes. You're a eukaryote, and so am I. Glad to meet you. Even single-celled eukaryotes can be vastly larger and more complicated than typical bacteria or archaea. They're able to grow so big because they found a way to delegate their energy production activities to mitochondria, vital internal cellular structures we'll explore in more detail in a moment. ATP power. We have seen how bacterial cells generate an electrical potential by pumping protons into the space between their cell membrane and their outer cell wall. But how do they actually use that power? In any energy-using system, such as an organism, a household, or a city, it helps to have a medium for storing and transferring energy. In a typical medieval household, firewood served that function. In modern cities, gasoline is one of our primary media for storing and transferring energy. Adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, is the firewood or gasoline of the cell. The primary energy-yielding activity of the eukaryote cell is respiration, which at the cellular level is the breaking down of glucose, food, with oxygen. There's also an anaerobic pathway for ATP creation, fermentation, which yeast are really good at. Care for a beer? But let's stick with respiration, because it's more relevant for understanding the energy pathways in most plants and animals. As a result of various chemical transformations, one molecule of glucose will yield up to 36 molecules of ATP, which can be stored or circulated until needed. The ATP molecule features a chain of 3 phosphate atoms. When the third of those atoms is broken off through a chemical process, ATP becomes ADP, adenosine diphosphate, and energy is released and available for immediate use. The ADP can then be recycled by adding back another phosphate atom, which, of course, requires energy. ATP is actually better than firewood or gasoline in that it can be endlessly recycled. In bacteria, energy generation can take many routes, but all have one process in common: the electrical potential that develops across the inner membrane, which generates a proton motive force that drives protons through a molecular structure known as the ATP synthase complex. Generating ATP from ADP by adding a phosphate atom to the chain. By the way, if this sounds complicated, it is. There are many textbooks devoted to explaining it, and researchers are still learning more about the energy pathways of super tiny individual cells. Cells use the energy from ATP for just about everything they do, including synthesizing DNA and RNA. Bacteria and archaea make ATP in ATP synthase complexes on the cell membrane. In eukaryotes, those structures are located in mitochondria. Now's the time to talk about these remarkable structures. Mitochondrial power. Eukaryotes differ from bacteria and archaea not just because the former have nuclei, but also because they have organelles, which are like cells within the cell. The most important of the organelles are mitochondria, of which there may be hundreds in each eukaryote cell. Mitochondria generate virtually all of a eukaryote's cell's ATP. They look like bacteria, and that's because they once were free-living bacteria that took up residence inside larger cells, probably a type of archaea, some 2 billion years ago. They have their own genomes, separate from the cell's genome that's housed in the cell nucleus. Eukaryotes have a cell membrane, but unlike bacteria, no rigid cell wall. That means they cannot use the space between membrane and wall as a battery, the way bacteria do. The ancestors of eukaryotes had cell walls, but once they acquired mitochondria, it was possible to tear down that wall and delegate energy generation to their mitochondria. Ditching the cell wall meant that eukaryotes could change shape and become true predators, like the amoeba, which engulfs its prey. See power from eating below. Within mitochondria, proton pumping occurs across a highly folded inner membrane. The cell delivers electron source material to the mitochondria. The latter then store the energy from the source material as ATP and deliver the ATP to the cell for all its various energy-using functions. This neat trade-off made complexity possible. The power of complexity. For bacteria, not having mitochondria is a limit on size. Double the size of a bacterial cell, and it can produce only half the ATP per unit of volume. Meanwhile, the larger cell needs more energy for all its cellular functions. That's why bacteria, on the whole, have stayed extremely small. Not so the eukaryotes. Single-celled eukaryotes can be hundreds, even thousands of times the size of a typical bacterium. Need more energy? Just make more mitochondria. Once energy production was delegated to mitochondria, cells could grow larger and also join each other in coordinated groups in which they each took on specialized tasks. Mitochondria made complexity possible. Natural selection made complexity attractive. Bigger, more specialized, and more complex creatures could more efficiently exploit resources or escape predators. Natural selection acted like a ratchet, turning random variation into a trajectory. And that trajectory has led us up the ramp of complexity. If eukaryotes with mitochondria hadn't evolved, the story of life on Earth would have been all about single-celled bacteria and archaea. Animals and plants would never have seen the light of day if it hadn't been for that incident 2 billion years ago when a primitive bacterium took up residence inside an archaeon and they found a mutually beneficial way to live and work together. This may have been a fluke, unlikely to be duplicated in bacterial colonies on other planets throughout the universe. If that's the case, complex life may be unique to Earth. Gene power. Consider the lowly Escherichia coli, usually known by its nickname E. coli, one of the many species of bacteria found in the human gut. You are probably host to millions of them right now. An organism that can live with or without air, E. coli is harmless in most of its strains, but some forms, if ingested, will make you very sick. These tiny rod-shaped critters derive their energy from semi-digested food in the lower intestines of animals, from feces, or from prepared cultures in petri dishes. E. coli are by far the most popular subjects for lab experiments, so scientists know a lot about them. Though it is one of the simplest organisms, and its size is measured in microns, each individual E. coli has a cell wall composed of cellulose, plus a plasma membrane and all the various proton-pumping and ATP-generating equipment discussed above. Internal systems regulate its functions and transport materials through its cell wall to spots where metabolism occurs. Altogether, the E. coli cell is like a tiny factory with control centers, energy production sites, and chemical synthesis chambers. It also contains a string of DNA organized as genes. Without this DNA string, the E. coli cell would not be able to organize and reproduce its other structures. All living organisms are made up of cells. In many cases, like E. coli, only a single cell that contain genetic material. In bacteria and archaea, DNA is just a single strand floating in the cell's cytoplasm. In eukaryotes, DNA is stored in the cell's nucleus. Wherever you find it, DNA acts as a blueprint for the manufacture of proteins, which the cell uses for everything it does. Genes conserve the organism's basic structures and functions through generations of reproduction. As the building blocks of heredity, genes also confer the power of mutation, enabling successive generations to adapt to environmental change. Mutations, however, can pose a risk. Many actually reduce the cell's viability and the organism's survival potential. That's one of the reasons why nuclear radiation, which triggers high rates of random genetic mutations, is generally to be avoided. The power of reproduction. While single-celled organisms like E. coli reproduce through cell division, mitosis, most multi-celled plants and animals have adopted sexual reproduction. Either way, the power of reproduction is one of the keys to life's success. Reproduction enables any given type of organism to grow in number, taking advantage of more resources and occupying more territory, hence maximizing its collective power. The reproduction of any cell requires energy, some of which is used for copying the DNA blueprint. Mistakes in copying can be expensive or even deadly. The vast potential of reproduction is illustrated in the concept of doubling time, the amount of time in which a species can double its population size. Imagine a pond with a patch of algae on its surface. If the algal population grows at 10% per hour, the total number of algae will double every 7 hours. If the algae occupied 1/20th of the pond surface when our observation started, they would take up 1/10th of the surface after 7 hours, 1/5th after 14 hours, 2/5 after 21 hours, and 4/5, nearly the entire surface, after a mere 28 hours. The compounded, or exponential, growth of any physical system accelerates until it hits a limit, such as the boundaries of the pond's surface, in our example. Bacteria can reproduce much faster than that. They can divide every 20 minutes through an energy-intensive process that requires making a complete copy of the entire DNA blueprint. Starting with a single bacterium, if doubling continued for just 2 days, the resulting colony would weigh 2,664 times the weight of the Earth. Obviously, this never actually happens. That's because bacteria are normally half-starved, and when they run out of food, they pass into a nearly inert state in which their rate of mitosis slows dramatically. It's worth noting that even though humans reproduce far more slowly than bacteria or algae, the doubling time principle still holds. at 1% annual population growth rate, which is lower than the current global average, the total human population doubles in about 70 years. In reality, 1 billion humans, our global population level in 1820, became 2 billion in 1927, 4 billion in 1974, and we are roughly 8 billion today. While population growth confers the advantage of greater collective power, it runs the risk of overwhelming limited resources. Hence, some human societies, such as China and Cuba in recent decades, have sought to moderate population growth, partly as a way of staving off resource scarcity, while other societies, including ancient states in Mesopotamia and China, and European Americans during the 18th and 19th centuries, have deliberately sought to increase their population growth rate as a way of competing with other societies or maximizing their power in other ways. The power of self-limitation. Complexity confers benefits, as discussed above, but it also entails costs and trade-offs. To live in a multi-celled organism, each cell must submit to the severest of limits, death. If cells didn't die, the multi-celled organism couldn't live. That's because individual cells eventually wear out or become damaged. If the body had no way of eliminating and reabsorbing them, whole subsystems would become dysfunctional fairly quickly, imperiling the entire individual. This does happen occasionally anyway, and the result is cancer. To prevent this, cells are programmed to commit suicide when instructed to do so by a molecular police force. It turns out that mitochondria and power play key roles. The loss of electrical potential across the folded membranes within the mitochondria of a cell is a trigger that invariably leads to cell suicide. This self-subordination of the individual to the needs of the whole is seen also in groups of highly cooperative organisms, such as ants. Among exploding ants, Colobopsis saundersi, found in Malaysia and Brunei, workers produce a toxic fluid in their abdomens. When the colony is attacked, some of the workers sacrifice themselves by exploding, releasing the toxin and killing the invaders. Self-limitation and self-sacrifice might seem to contradict the maximum power principle. They don't, because groups of ultra-social creatures act as superorganisms. In these cases, evolution is acting at the group level rather than the individual level. We'll explore that concept further, especially as it relates to humans, in chapters 3, 6, and 7. Power from photosynthesis. Photosynthesis, which powers nearly all multicelled life on Earth, got its start in cyanobacteria, which appeared around 2.7 billion years ago. The chemistry of photosynthesis essentially runs respiration backward. Respiration uses glucose and oxygen to make water, CO2, and energy. Photosynthesis uses energy from sunlight, plus water and CO2, to make glucose and oxygen. Plants use some of the glucose they make to fuel respiration and release energy. The rest is incorporated into their tissues and becomes leaves, stems, and roots. Within plant cells, photosynthesis takes place in organelles called chloroplasts. These appear to have originated as cyanobacteria, that is, bacteria able to perform photosynthesis, which roughly 500 million years ago found a cozy living arrangement within some eukaryote cells, much the way mitochondria had already done. Green plants have the ability to use the energy of sunlight directly to build body tissues from little more than air and water. Plants also need nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and trace elements, but these do not make up the bulk of plant tissues. In doing so, they store energy in the chemical bonds between the atoms of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen that make up the carbohydrates composing a plant's body. The power of photosynthesis has enabled green plants to spread across the surface of the planet, wherever there are sufficient water sources and nutrients. Plants, most often in the forms of phytoplankton and kelp, are also dispersed throughout suitable areas of oceans, streams, and lakes. It is largely through photosynthesis that the sun's energy is able to power multicelled organisms throughout the biosphere. Biologists call green plants producers because they essentially make their own food, as opposed to consumers, a category that includes all animals, which have to eat other organisms or products of organisms to obtain their energy. Power from eating. By eating other organisms, consumers obtain the energy that is the source of their powers. At the same time, eating requires the exertion of energy. On a net basis, the energy derived from food must exceed the energy required to obtain and eat food if the organism is to survive. Bacteria are able to transport food through their cell wall by secreting enzymes onto the food to break it down into simpler forms that can be transported through the wall. Eukaryote cells, which don't have rigid walls, are able to transport nutrients directly through the thinner cell membrane. The first true predators were eukaryotic cells that were able to engulf their prey, mostly bacteria, algae, and particles of formerly living cells, by flowing around it and enclosing it as a food vacuole within which it could be digested. This process, known as phagocytosis, is how the amoeba and many other protozoa still make their living. Eating is easier to understand intuitively in big, multicelled animals because it's an activity we ourselves engage in frequently, sometimes with great pleasure. Herbivores eat plants. Carnivores eat other animals. Secondary carnivores, like many snakes and fish, eat other carnivores. Decomposers, such as fungi, eat the dead bodies of other organisms, gradually turning them into soil, which helps support the growth of producers. When a white-tailed deer, a herbivore, stops along its journey through a meadow to eat a dandelion, a producer, only about a tenth of the dandelion's total energy stored as carbohydrate can be absorbed and used to power the animal. Similarly, when a mountain lion, a carnivore, stalks and kills that deer, only about a tenth of the total energy is transferred. Biologists often describe the overall results in terms of a food or energy pyramid by which energy moves through the ecosystem. At each stage, most energy and materials are lost as heat and waste rather than being converted into work or bodily tissues. Thus, a typical terrestrial ecosystem can support only one carnivore to 10 or more herbivores of similar body mass, one secondary carnivore to every 10 or more primary carnivores, and so on. Think of the energy pyramid as a visualization of power getting distributed through the biological world. It enters at the bottom and works its way up, at each level becoming more concentrated. Howard Odum termed this concentration of energy transformity. Yet organisms at the base of the pyramid, as a result of being far more numerous and having far greater total biomass, are collectively just as powerful in their way as the top predators at the pyramid's apex, though humanity's use of fossil fuels has temporarily upset that balance, as we'll see later on. Power and bodies. The power of size. We've already discussed some of the advantages of bigness, but there's a lot more to say on this score. On average, larger animals have a slower rate of metabolism and enjoy a longer life than smaller ones. The important thing to note is that their individual cells actually need fewer nutrients. As biologist Nick Lane colorfully puts it, an elephant-sized pile of mice would consume 20 times more food and oxygen every minute than the elephant itself does. A mouse has to eat half its body weight every day to fend off starvation, while a human survives eating only 2% of body weight daily. It turns out that as animals get bigger, their metabolic rate slows by a factor that roughly corresponds to the ratio of surface area to mass. This is known as Kleiber's law, one of the power laws of biology. There are two ways of looking at this situation. First, the cheery way. Being big offers the advantage of efficiency and economy of scale. The less cheery way. This increase of efficiency with growth in size is at least partly a result of the burgeoning bulk of the supply network required to deliver food and oxygen to each cell. As the network grows, it forces constraints upon the animal's individual cells and their mitochondria. So these cells have to economize on energy, and they're not able to work as hard. Therefore, the ratio of the animal's maximum power to its weight falls with size. When it comes to lifespan, size seems to confer a less ambiguous advantage. The mouse lives 2 years on average, while the elephant may live 100 years. Altogether, the mouse is working harder and burning out quicker. However, there are a few anomalies in the size-lifespan continuum. Birds, bats, and humans live longer than they should, based on their size. A pigeon may live 35 years, while a similar-sized rat lives only 2. Many humans live longer than they otherwise would due to modern medicine, but it appears that the long lives of birds and bats are due to a genetic adaptation having to do with the production and accumulation of free radicals within cells. Scientists are trying to better understand what helps birds live so long. Some seabirds appear entirely immune to the diseases of old age, and to see whether humans could benefit from that knowledge. Some additional advantages of bigness: being of larger size aids in retaining heat, offers greater strength, reduces problems having to do with water surface tension, insects have a hard time taking a drink, and tends to optimize the function of organs, such as eyes, which are composed of cells of fixed size. More cells, better vision. Or that's the theory, anyway. I had to wear glasses when I was a kid, despite having eyes bigger than a hawk's. But there are also some additional disadvantages to bigness that are worth mentioning. Larger birds have to work harder to fly, and larger mammals struggle to make their way through thick vegetation or to walk on boggy ground. For a tiny animal, falling down is no big deal. For an elderly human, it can be fatal. Muscle power. There are lots of kinds of specialized cells within larger multicelled organisms. Let's look at just two kinds, muscles and neurons, which often work together and are particularly important for developing many of the unique powers enjoyed by animals, such as ourselves. First, muscles. They are the source of animals' powers of lifting and moving. See powers of motion below. But muscles do more than this. They are essential for breathing and for moving blood through veins and arteries. The heart is a muscle. And food through the digestive system. Muscles are made of long, thin cells grouped into bundles or fibers. They're powered by ATP, of course, and controlled by neurons. When a muscle fiber gets a signal from its nerve, proteins and chemicals release energy to either contract the muscle or relax it. Muscles make up about 40% of the total weight of a typical human and perform many specialized tasks, including moving the eyes and protecting the inner ear from loud noises. Neuron power. If muscles supply the brawn for animals, neurons are literally the brains, as well as providing the signaling channels for brains to convey their messages. Outside the brain, there are 3 types of neurons: sensory, motor, and interneurons, which connect spinal, motor, and sensory neurons. But within the brain, there are so many kinds of neurons that they are hard to neatly classify. Neurons get their messages across to other neurons using neurotransmitters. These are chemicals that can excite, inhibit, or modulate a neuron's activities. There are dozens of neurotransmitters, including dopamine. The brain has many dopamine pathways, and this particular neurotransmitter is involved in motor control, behavioral reward and reinforcement, and motivation. We'll discuss dopamine more in Chapter 6. Most neurons have a cell body, an axon, and dendrites. The axon extends from the cell body and often branches several times before ending at nerve terminals. Dendrites receive messages from other neurons and are covered with synapses, connecting them to axons from other neurons. The nervous system is a communications marvel. The human brain contains, on average, 100 billion neurons and operates at about 23 watts of power during wakefulness. Compared with electronic computers, this is an amazing level of power efficiency. While it is impossible to calculate precisely, the human brain's computational power has been estimated at a billion calculations per second. the world's fastest computer, using several megawatts of power, takes over half an hour to do what the human brain does each second. The power of sex. Asexual reproduction by way of mitosis has worked fine for bacteria and other single-celled creatures for billions of years. Why wasn't it maintained in all bigger multi-celled creatures via self-cloning? After all, the alternative, sexual reproduction, reduces reproductive opportunities. With two sexes, reproduction is only possible with, at best, half the members of your species. Finding a mate can take time and effort, and there's no guarantee of success. Therefore, there must be some advantage that outweighs that cost. The advantage is genetic diversity. Among animals, males contribute sperm while females contribute eggs. Both pass along genes to the offspring, but only the mother passes along mitochondria and their genes to the next generation. Sexual reproduction generates unique and often beneficial combinations of genes that in most cases have already proven not to endanger survival. Greater genetic variety helps, for example, by increasing the chance that some of a population of beans, soybeans, or blackbirds will survive if a deadly infection occurs. Of course, sex introduces the possibility for all kinds of social power intrigues, imbalances, and abuses, some of which we'll explore further in later chapters. But in addition, sexual reproduction opens the door to sexual selection and beauty, which we'll turn to in a moment. Powers of perception. Sense organs give organisms powers to adapt to their environments, find food, locate potential mates, and avoid predators. Seeing, hearing, feeling, tasting, and smelling are only the most familiar of the possible senses, which also include the abilities to detect the Earth's magnetic field and to judge spatial orientation and degrees of moisture and acidity. Among animals, champions of perception include dogs, whose noses are about 40 times more acute than our own, birds, which have an ultraviolet color receptor in their eyes and can therefore see a whole dimension of color that's invisible to us, and bats, whose hearing can distinguish high-pitched echoes accurately enough and quickly enough to enable them to locate and catch flying insects. Plants don't have neuronal networks the way higher animals do. Nevertheless, plants have perception. Nearly all exhibit photosensitivity and the ability to sense orientation in space. That is, they perceive and actively respond to gravity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.